If I told you that every time you took a tablet for your headache, it had a 5% chance of killing you, would you take it? The answer depends on if I'm using the same dodgy system of calculation of risks that they use in nuclear radiation. We've all heard of the big nuclear reactor disasters such as Chernobyl and Fukushima, but how many people actually were killed? Well, for Fukushima, nobody died directly, but maybe one person died sometime afterwards. But there were perhaps a few thousand that died early due to suicide, stress, and interruption of medical care, not from the radiation. And we must remember that about 20,000 people died from the earthquake and the tsunami. So the nuclear accident was expensive and it was messy, but not a particularly big loss of life. Chernobyl was far worse, but there were about 30 direct deaths. The number that died after due to long-term radiation exposure is a huge question. Some estimates put this as high as 60,000. But we will see here that this is based on broken science, very badly broken. Before we talk about this problem, I want to mention the brilliant science where we use, for example, radiation to kill cancer. I had quite a few of my students go on to become medical physicists, and they worked on the machines to fight cancer. And there's a fine line between killing the cancer with a huge dose of radiation and not allowing the dose to affect other parts of the body that you don't want to damage. Totally wonderful stuff. And nuclear reactors are amazing machines too, clean, reliable, very safe, provided you don't build a dodgy old Russian reactor or put your reactor really close to the sea where there's earthquakes and a tsunami coming. But we should stay focused. What about the risk of dying from a certain dose of radiation? Now, this is a big deal because most people are unnecessarily terrified of very low doses of radiation. How do we calculate the risk? Well, the risk obviously varies depending on the dose you get. Now, an extreme dose like those people who basically walked into a melted down reactor at Chernobyl, well, there was a 100% chance that they were going to die within weeks from the radiation. But for lower doses, it might take decades for the effects to become apparent, maybe through cancer, that develop late in life. And it can be very hard to tell if somebody has died from the radiation early on or from other things that cause cancer. Now, it's regarded as bad form to do experiments on people by exposing them deliberately to radiation at different levels and checking to see whether they die. So for lots of radiation safety standards, they use a thing called the linear no threshold hypothesis, which works like this. We draw a graph with the mortality risk and the dose, and usually we have a pretty good idea of what will kill you for certain. So this point here is where the dose, maybe where people were exposed to radiation from the atom bomb blast at Hiroshima or exposed to the huge doses of Chernobyl. But it assumes that as the dose gets lower, the chance of dying gets lower in a nice straight line fashion. But this ignores quite a few things. Firstly, we're all exposed to radiation in our everyday lives. Turns out there's lots of radiation coming out of the ground because there's lots of radioactive material in the ground, totally naturally. I calculate that my backyard, there's about 5 kilograms of uranium in the top meter of soil, and there's lots of radiation coming from outer space in the form of cosmic rays. So do these natural low doses, which all 7 billion people on Earth are exposed to, do they have the risks described by this curve? Is it safe to go out into the garden? Before I answer that question, let's look at another two examples. A human being has about 5 litres of blood, and when people go to the blood bank to give blood, they take about 0.5 litre, which is about 10% of your blood. If you had an accident and lost 2 litres of blood, which is 40% of your blood, well, you'd die for sure, pretty much. So let's plot these numbers on the graph. 2 litres lost, 100% mortality, draw the linear relationship, and now draw the point where we give 0.5 litre of blood and calculate the chance is about 25% of dying. In America each year, people donate about 10 million units of blood. 25% of those people will die from that donation. So 2.5 million people are killed each year from donating blood. Or how about headache tablets, say paracetamol? A lethal dose might be, say, 20 tablets. It's not very many, and tragically, some overdoses are deliberately with people thinking it will make them unconscious, which is wrong. It's a very nasty way to go. Anyway, if you take two tablets and if you use the linear no threshold hypothesis, you have a 10% chance of dying, right? Well, let's say half the population take a headache tablet every year, so we just killed off 500 million people every year. Now, I'm sure you can see that this is just complete and utter rubbish. Now, the reason is that for almost everything, including radiation, there certainly is a lethal dose. Even pure water will kill you if you drink enough. But the shape of the dose mortality curve is most, for most medicines, looks like this. If you take two tablets, you don't die and your headache gets much better. But if you take more than the recommended dose, you can get into trouble real quick. So taking the proper dose is basically a negligible risk. So why on earth do we use these silly mortality curves for disasters such as Chernobyl, which calculate ridiculously high mortality? It's a good question. And it basically is because people wanted to be super safe. Now you might think that, well, it's better to exaggerate the risk. You can't be too safe. But actually you can. By exaggerating the risk, you encourage behaviour or even government policy that can do far more damage than a little bit of radiation. So for example, after Chernobyl accident, because the cloud of radiation reached Europe, albeit at extremely low doses, people panicked because of the perceived risk from the radiation. There was an increase in pregnancy terminations in Greece that is estimated to be 23% of the fetuses were aborted, and that was totally unnecessary. Now, that's a lot of children that were not born, far more than the number of deaths from the radiation. You can understand it if you're carrying a baby and the press is screaming that the radiation is coming and the scientists are not putting the whole thing in its proper perspective, you're going to panic. Then there's the fear of nuclear power, which is actually the cleanest and least dangerous of any form of energy. How many deaths have been caused because we have not used nuclear power over the last few decades? Mining coal is very dangerous. Heck, it's more people have died from servicing wind turbines than have died in nuclear accidents in Western countries. I spoke to one of my ex-students who helps with radiation therapy to kill cancers, and he said he often has to have a sort of a split personality. When he's irradiating patients, he has to make sure that the cancer is in the high mortality zone of the curve, but the cells surrounding the cancer are in the low mortality part of this curve. But for his own safety, the regulations insist that the wrong linear relationship has to be used, which he knows is complete rubbish. Anything like this where we are using a science which is wrong is broken science, and broken science means almost always bad regulations, people making bad decisions because they have the wrong information. And it's also bad for the credibility of science in general. Anyway, I think I'm going to go into my garden and breathe a little bit of fresh radiation that's being emitted and smell the roses.